you don't, it was really nice meeting you. So I hope I see you in London, but I'll know if you're not there. No, it's good to meet all of you. It's been wonderful being here. I've just loved it. I'm just a bit sad that my sweetie couldn't come along because she just had knee surgery. And two torn meniscuses, or menisci, whatever the plural for meniscus would be. And so she was in a lot of pain and some recovery time before we go to Ireland. When I left her, she was taking a bunch of those Percocet things. And I had no idea she knew the lyrics to so many old Frank Sinatra songs. But I left her singing some Frank Sinatra song, and she was asking me to take her to the skate park. I don't know what that was about. So I think she's going to be okay. But if you get to come to England with everybody, you'll get to meet my sweetheart there. So she's an amazing lady and a wonderful grandmother. Now, we have 5 grandbabies now. Yeah, the oldest one's 5. So when you got 5 under 5, it's like a room full of puppies. Just always a moving. Well, let's turn to, we're going to start in Psalm 32 is kind of a jumping off place. When you get to Psalm 32, just stick your thumb in there and then jump over to Psalm 89 for a second. And I'll start in Psalm 89 and then we'll kick right back over to Psalm 32 real quick. Psalm 89 is one of my favorite psalms. I've got a bunch of favorite psalms. This is certainly one of them. And it really paints the picture of what the sound would have looked like. If you can see a sound, and they know that we can. Actually, science has determined that you can see sound and you can hear light. And it's just on a frequency because it's all frequency, as is all of creation and all of nature. But I don't want to get too deep into the sciences of that. What I want us to look at is this is a picture of what the culture would have been like in the days of the Tabernacle of David. And I'm sure you're familiar with the Tabernacle of David. That was the time and the season in history where God chose a young shepherd boy who's sitting out in the middle of the meadows of obscurity, if you will, just hidden away out there worshiping God. And while he was worshiping, he was playing either a shepherd's pipe or a kinnor, a shepherd's harp. And that would have been a smaller harp. He played 4 different kinds of harps. He played a nebel, a lira, he played a kinnor and a sheminith. But the one that he played out in the field had a percussive sound, and it released the sound of joy. We typically think that David would have been sitting in a field with this contemplative, meditating, kind of beautiful, calm to calm the sheep kind of sounds. But that instrument was actually designed and given to joy. So if you would have looked out in the field, in the shepherd's field, and found David in it, he might have been dancing all over the field, just some grass flying and dust stirred up under his feet and just singing for all the joy that there was in him. And God so appreciated the expression of his heart that he said, and it's the only guy God ever said this about in all of Scripture. He said, now there's a guy after my own heart. And remember, he's just a shepherd boy. He has no ambition to be the king. He has no ambition to be a giant killer. He has no political prowess or ambition. That's not anywhere in his desire. But God looked at him and says, there's a man after my own heart. I can just hear God now saying, so I think I'll just give it to him. Because he's already given his heart away, I'll give him mine. And now this young shepherd boy has God's heart. And when you have God's heart, you're going to have God's heart for the political realm and for the educational systems and for the medical world and for. Just throw all the 7 mountains in there for a minute. You know, people that carry God's heart for those things. And so God saw his heart. And then after that, you see another major occurrence that happened is this shepherd boy out there in obscurity worshiping God, and his father calls him in from the field and says, would you go and serve your brothers? And because they're fighting with Saul over there. And we know what was going on over there with Saul. A giant was holding them all captive to his words. And nobody was fighting a giant. They were all standing in fear, discouragement, depression, and dismayed, standing on the hill. And then, but notice, David was a worshiper. So when the father called him in, worship always leads to obedience. And obedience will always lead to servanthood. And so when David, this young shepherd boy, came as a worshiper and the father's desire was about to be lived out, so he walked in servanthood, and there he shows up at the battle where there was no battle. Because for 40 days, all that would have been going on over there is a giant coming out every morning and intimidating everybody and putting fear in them and closing down their destiny, shutting down their destiny, as well as closing their voices in fear. So they had lost their song, they had lost their future, they had lost their destiny. Everything was being controlled by a Philistine with a big mouth. And Philistine means to roll in the dust or to wallow in self. And Goliath, his name means soothsayer. So this soothsaying, false prophetic, powerful proclamation that they're listening to is carrying fear and pain, dismay, discouragement, all this negative dynamic. And that's what he's throwing into the air. That's what they're hearing. And then it says, and then David showed up. And when David walked into that atmosphere, now the whole dynamic changed. Because you had a whole mountaintop covered with people with an opinion, but one guy had a rock. Because he didn't fall into line with their opinions. And he didn't fall into line with the things that they were saying. Because what they were saying was, you know, man, hey, have you seen this giant? And their fear caused them to say things like, man, he's too big to mess with. He's too big to hit. David said, no, are you kidding? I've seen this giant. He's too big to miss. Because he wasn't thinking like they were thinking. His whole thought process is, why? Because he was coming from a mindset of joy and presence of the Lord. He was over there being what he was created to be, releasing the sound of his poetry and his music and his song and his dance into the presence of the Lord. Without an audience of any kind other than the presence of God. So he was carrying that interaction, so all his knowings was coming from that place. And then you remember what his brothers said, hey, what are you doing, you little knucklehead? We know what you're out here doing. We know what you're all about. And notice this, began to accuse him of the very things that they were carrying in their heart. Do you ever notice when you step out of the ranks into a release of God in your life, a lot of times you're going to have relatives that are going to accuse you of their issue, you know, and try to stop the whole thing. He didn't fall to it. He said, wait a minute. Have you heard what this clown's saying about my God? He's cursing God. It ain't nothing. It's not about armies and stuff. This is about, what did you hear what he's saying about God? The God, the one that I love, the one that's caused life to be in me. That's what's going on here. And then he challenged everybody there and said, is there not a cause? And what they said to him, hey, you know what, David? Whoever kills the giant, you know what? You get the girl, the gold, the glory, you get the bling, you get a tax write-off. You know, everything was, and it's, in other words, they girls, gold, glory, and money means they were appealing to him as a musician. Look at the person beside him and say, I don't think I'd have said that. I believe I'd let that go. But look at the very things. Look at the very things that the world uses to appeal to all that you get, and the identity and self-worth and the money and the this and the career and all the stuff that you get. But that wasn't what that's when he said, wait a minute, is there not a cause here? He is defying the God that I love with all my heart. And the short version of this story is he was the only one. After worship led to obedience, obedience leads to servanthood, and the servanthood will always lead to passion, when you hear the words of the enemy against your God, he stepped out with passion in his heart, took him to a position that nobody else would take. So when he stepped, everybody else had taken a position of standing there every day shouting for the battle, but nobody went out and fought the giant. So their whole existence was around shouting at their enemies. How many years are we going to have shouting conferences before Goliaths start falling? You know, but he took a position nobody else would take. And when he stepped out of the passion of his heart, he stepped down on that ground. Everybody else said, man, don't go down there, David. That's a rocky place. But he didn't think like they did he? He said, are you kidding? Look at the ammo everywhere. There's ammunition everywhere. There's no ammunition up there where you are, you bunch of shouters. But no, that changed nothing. But down here, this is where the ammunition is, in the lowest place of all. And when he stepped into the lowest place of all, that's where he found the provision necessary to take out his enemy. And the Bible says that he reached down and he picked up five smooth stones. It actually doesn't. And if you purely want to know what he did, is he reached down and he picked up five smoothed stones that had already been prepared for that day of battle. God had already set all of nature in place to prepare what was necessary for him to take out the giant. And I've been there. I've been to the Valley of Elah. I've been there where those stones are. And I can tell you that the flint stones, they were made of flint, and they were about the size of your fist. And the scientists got and the physicists got involved in this thing, and they determined that what it would have taken, it would have taken a 3.5-foot sling to sling that thing the length of a football field and hit that giant square in the head, which it took a lot of precision. And so David did not kill the giant with a rock. He killed the giant with his heart. God directed the flight of the rock. And he knew it was a supernatural occurrence. So, but here's what happened. When he stepped out, of course, the giant was there. And when David stepped out, though, and took that position nobody else would take, he began to move in prophecy. He began to prophesy to his enemy. I'm going to take that big ugly head off you today, and I'm going to da-da-da-da-da-da. It hadn't happened yet, so we know it was prophecy. But before he began to prophesy, as he was prophesying, he released a sound that had not been heard. It was a new sound. Woo, woo, woo. Nobody had heard that for 40 days because they'd been listening to the giant's voice for 40 days. But now you hear a new sound. And then when he, and that, I think that was the beginning of rock music. Oh, yeah. Yeah, he released the, because listen what happened. He released, when he, and he released, rung his bell. And when he rung his bell, what he had done is he released a lyric of his own life that would be sung throughout his life and beyond. Because that day, he released the rock of the salvation of Israel. Everybody was now released into their destiny and into their purpose. Because, and he wrote songs about it till the day he died. The rock of the salvation of Israel became a metaphorical or prophetic and beautiful picture of the rock of the rock of salvation, Jesus, that would one day come. But when he released that rock, the giant hit the ground like a sack of feed. And then just like his prophecy was, he went over and cut the head off of that thing. And he's running down the road carrying this big old ugly head. And when he comes to the gates of the city, there's where he finds the women, and the daughters and wives, positioned on the walls of intercession at the gates of the city, crying out and just waiting for any kind of news to come. They don't know if they're going to be taken captive. They don't know if they're going to be killed. They don't know if it's going to be 70 years of slavery under the Philistines. They don't know if life is over. They don't know anything, and they're not hearing anything. And now they look up, and here comes a little red-headed kid running down the road, dragging a head half big as he is. And it says, and immediately they begin to sing and rejoice and whirl, and they get and begin to sing a prophetic song with their dance, which means that they were released into their prophetic gift just like everybody else on the hill. The whole nation of Israel is now stepping forward, and they got their song back. And when they got their song and their sound back, did you know that every one of the 9 revivals in the Old Testament where worship would be restored, that's where they get their song back. I talked to you the other night about when Egypt was under bondage for 400 years and had no song, no dance, no creativity, no life, no color, no voice of any kind. But when they stepped across the Red Sea and they got their song back, now that very same people that had no express creativity whatsoever, they turn out to be the greatest filmmakers, the greatest novelists, the greatest composers, the greatest songwriters, the greatest doctors and scientists and physicians. All of the wonder of the redemptive giftings that were in that people began to be lived out then once they got their song back. And I believe that's one of the reasons that it's so critical that the people of God have their song alive in them, their poetry alive in them, their art alive in them. If you're a wood carver, carve it to the glory of God. We're all created by the Creator to be creative. And if we're not, and when we're walking with God, we should be walking in the full release of our creativity. And that's what all of them began to do. As soon as the Philistine, the one that was intimidating and putting the fear in them, as soon as that voice was shut, they start moving in what they were created to be. And that's the way the enemy loves to work on the mind of man. To roll in the dust, to wallow in self, and hear the soothsaying words that are manipulation and control that bring depression, despair, and loss of identity. When we don't know who we are, we won't be who we are. We will be whoever the enemy has imposed upon our minds to be. And there will be all kinds of conflict around our lives that takes the joy of just simply being who we're created to be. We'll be striving to do. And that's what you had there. You had a bunch of soldiers standing on the hill striving to figure out how to get into a new day. And here's one in his innocence and purity of worship stepped up and said, "This is what a new day looks like," and released the sound. I can still sometimes just hear David walking out there, and in his own heart he said, we will. You know, he's going to... And then when he goes running by, and by the way, those women are out there to say, "What's the news?" They didn't have to know the news; they could see the news. And he just right on past them up. And there, where do you see him next? He shows up at the gates of Jerusalem. No, he don't. There is no Jerusalem yet. There's no such thing as Jerusalem yet. It was a Jebusite fortress. It wasn't Jerusalem. He showed up with his head of the enemy and basically said, "Next. You guys, you're out of here next. This is going to be the place where song and sound and dance and wonder and joy and rejoicing." And sure enough, that's the very place that wound up bringing the Ark of God's presence back to the very gate that he had showed the head to. And to that very gate became the gate of Zion. To that very gate would become the place where the song was sung. "Lift up your heads, O ye gates, lift up your heads, everlasting doors. Let the King of Glory come in." The presence of God was brought in there, was singing and rejoicing and dancing. And then for 33 years, 24 hours a day, the song didn't stop. Once that song started, there was no silence for 33 years. Think about this. That song lasted the same length of Jesus' life, the son of David. So he showed up there, and once that song kicked in, the first thing he did is he established those to thank, to praise, and to record. That's in 1 Chronicles 16:4. Thank, praise, and record. And he set a whole guild of musicians and singers and artists and dancers and the joy of, and God was in their midst for 33 years. And those recorders were the ones that would follow David around, and 7 times a day he would break into a song, even though he's the king. So he has all this position and responsibility and all that, but 7 times a day, you don't care if there's committee meetings, you don't care if there's press conferences, whatever. The king, 7 times a day, He reaches over and grabs an old guitar and just begins to sing. I would imagine it was an old Martin harp, I would just think. And he grabbed a hold of that harp. Out, now here would come the spontaneous song flowing out of him, of the acknowledging and interacting with God. And now that spontaneous song, the recorders, or Zakar, would capture that, and he'd say, "All right, get this over to the chief musician upon so and so. This is maybe upon Shoshani Duth. This is a trumpet of assemblage. Will actually be the sound that will interpret what I'm sensing in the spirit when I sing this." There has to be a sound that corresponds with it, that carries the weightiness of the presence of the voice of God, because music is not about entertaining folks. Music is about the nature of God being heralded through the air on the wings of sound, bypassing the intellectual realm, going straight to the spirit and changing the spirit to the point that the DNA, even the DNA structure, aligns with what God has determined the next generation will sing. Think about that. Music is a DNA. They've determined that the DNA is actually a musical decoding. So down through the ages, the promises of God, born out of the spontaneity of a prophetic shepherd boy, who in that shepherd's field would even do things like praise God to the point that 1,000 years later in that shepherd's field, heaven opened up and a sound came, and Jesus was born in a manger in that shepherd's field. And that's the weightiness of what this guy was carrying in his worship. And now, so he set up a whole generation, 33 years, same length of Jesus' life, also prophesying that the Son of David would one day come as the Song of Songs when he comes. It's amazing to me how God ordered generation after generation for the poets and the prophets to capture the language of God, turn it into a lyric that we get to agree with as we sing the Word of God over and over and over. And so it tells us that the Word of God, or prophecy, is not just about predicting what will be, it's about creating what will be, because the promises are found in the weightiness of the prophecies that would be sung. David set all that in motion, and then when he would break into one of those songs, and I don't know if you know it or not, but David was a blues singer. He would get up in the morning and just sing, howling some old blues tune, you know, my enemies are out to kill me, they're gonna, he had that, I would just throw myself at the ground, but I know I'd miss, and he'd be all depressed and tore up, but right in the middle of that, I will praise the Lord my God, who is worthy to be praised. And he would rise up out of that. I love what Steve said yesterday. What was it? Prayer always prophesies. Praise always prophesies. When you're, any time that you're acknowledging and accessing the presence of God, the silence is broken. And when that silence is broken, it'll come forth in prayer, praise, prophecy, and what those are promises. So what David set in motion here was those that would carry the songs of promise. And right here in Psalm 89 is a beautiful picture of it. It says, in your Bible, in the inscription there, does it say, remembering the covenant with David and sorrow for lost blessing. And then it says, in my Bible, on page 521, it says, a contemplation of Ethan the Ezrahite. Now, contemplation, this means Ethan, who was one of the musicians, he rises up in the morning in the same way that David had set it in motion. When he gets up in the morning, he starts contemplating and interacting with God. While he's meditating, his poetry starts coming alive, and of course, he just writes this song. And it says, so a contemplation, or in Hebrew, it's the word maskil. And so as he's acknowledging and interacting with God, out of this contemplation, and it says of Ethan, and Ethan's name means he who endures. The Ezrahite, it says. And the word Ezrahite, it speaks of identity. Yes, I'm an Ezrahite, but what an Ezrahite means is one who is raised up out of the soil. So there was a territorial, a land commitment, if you will. He was committed to hear the sound of the song of the land. And that's one of the reasons that God sent his musical culture, if you will, all over the world. Because he wants all of creation and all of the earth to give up its song. And down through the ages, he's always had those in every culture that would hear the sound of the song of the land and sing that and awaken creation unto worship. Lead creation in worship. That's why David would have them write songs like, praise the Lord, sun, praise the Lord, moon, praise the Lord, stars, praise the Lord, river, praise the Lord, grass of the field, all of creation. And their job was is to go around and awaken creation to the beauty and the wonder. And what he had done is he had caused creation to declare his glory and awaken the poets to sing. And so there was a combination of the voice of creation and the voice of man who was not in the earth. He was on the earth. He was no longer in the earth. He had been raised up out of the soil. Yeah, right? Yeah. So you see that picture, up out of the dirt we were raised. And when Adam came up out of the dirt, the first thing he found was his song, his response, his interaction with God. Yeah. And every day he would meet with God in the cool of the evening in the garden, where creation was declaring his glory and interaction with the presence of God was going on. What an awesome place to be. And now you have a whole guild of musicians who understand this because they're rightly connected. It sounds a little bit new agey, but I'm not afraid of new age. I understand recycled paganism and I know what that is. But also, a lot of the New Agers have a sensitivity and sensibility in the spirit realm that we could learn a whole lot from. And we might even access their hearts and let them see the wonder of who the God of creation is rather than worshiping creation, right? Yeah. Yeah. Well, if our song was carrying the true power and the presence of God, when our song is released and our creativity is released, God would use that over. The overflow of our worship is the greatest tool of evangelism we have. Because the overflow of our worship is what causes our purpose to come into its fullness. That's why Jesus, if you remember, you had 33 years, but at year 30, the first time he shows up, he comes walking down through the crowd to the river. And remember, there's John the Baptist waiting there. And John the Baptist was not the only one in this picture. When Jesus stepped out of obscurity and out of the silence into that moment, heaven opened up and said, this is my beloved. The word beloved son. Beloved son. This is my David. The word beloved is the word David. This is the son of David. This is the one carrying the sound. This is the one that'll redeem all of humanity to the right relationship with the Father through their sound and through their song. He said, my beloved son, where if you dig around in the etymology of some of these terms, son is where we get the word sonic or sound. This is the sound of God's heart being expressed in the earth. It's my beloved son in whom I'm well pleased. What's the very next voice you hear? Well, if thou be the son of God. So anytime the sound of heaven comes and there's a to identify who we truly are, the next voice will be one, what if? Begin to challenge the very thing that you've heard God. And then through the conflict that immediately came to Jesus, it was all spelled out. Because the very first thing that happened when he says, if thou be the Son of God, and then here comes the temptation. And I looked up the word tempted, and you know what it means? Tempted, that's what it means. That means he had to consider the things that were proposed. Jesus had to consider it. Otherwise, it wasn't temptation. And so first thing he did is, he turned this stone into bread. I don't know if that's in case a fight breaks out, I want to be hit with a biscuit, not with a rock. But you know what he was really saying? Is he was saying, well, if you really are Jesus, if you really are the Son of God, if you really are the Redeemer, if you really are the one that'll restore righteousness and right relationship, just do this. Just alter matter. Oh, you got to just alter matter, then we'll know that's who you are. Well, Jesus can alter matter. He don't have to prove anything to the enemy. He can alter matter. He can turn water into wine. Alter matter? Are you kidding? He can walk up to that wall and come into agreement with the frequency that it vibrates in and walk right through the wall. Matter is no matter for Jesus. Right? So that one didn't work. And then he takes him to a high place and he says, well, all right, tell you what, just defy gravity. If you just jump off of here, you know, you'll have your kingdom. Well, you'll have what you came for. Everybody will see your greatness and you'll have, in other words, if you go ahead and do what I say prematurely, you'll get your kingdom. And Jesus can defy gravity, can't he? He can walk on water. He can walk up to the Sea of Galilee and come into agreement with the frequency that the water vibrates at and change the surface tension on top of the water, and he becomes weightless and he walks right out across the water. No problem. He can defy gravity. But he's not going to do it at your word, rattlehead. That's what he's basically saying to the enemy. I'm not going to do anything at your command. And so now the enemy, he catches, finally gets it. I'll tell you what, I know what you're after. You're here to redeem the glory, the crown of glory that was lost with Adam. You're about restoring that kind of relationship of worship, aren't you? That's who you are. You're the one that was promised as the seed of woman that would one day bruise my head. You're the head bruiser. I'm on to you. You're the redeemer. I got it. I've heard all those prophecies too for thousands of years. See, the devil had already had lived thousands of years of paranoia, just wondering who this head bruiser is that's one day coming to get him. And now he realizes that this could really be him. So if you came to redeem the crown of glory lost in the garden, I'll tell you, I'll just give it to you. No sweat. You don't have to do the cross, the tomb, death, burial stuff. Forget that. Well, just one little thing. And then we're good, right? I'll just tell you, just worship me just for a sec. Just work. That's all. You know, you don't even have to do it wholeheartedly. Just a good worship right here. Yeah. Give me a song. Come on. Do you know the old tune? You know, I can just see the devil trying to manipulate him into one response. And because that's all it'll take. Because see, at one time, Lucifer was the worship leader in heaven, and but he didn't have to pick up a guitar to lead worship. He was a guitar. He didn't have to sit down to a piano. He was a piano. Within his very being was the ability to create the sound and reflect the light of the glory of the throne room of heaven. Had these stones resonate, and you know what his name was? The anointed cherub that covereth the throne of God. But when he's cast down, one day he's flying over the sea of glass, sees how beautiful he is. And from that day forward, he began to saturate the glory. Here's his job when you really look at it. There's the throne of heaven. And he would go before, in the presence of God. And his job was to lead all of creation, all of heaven, and all of creation in worship. So he would go before the throne of God with these stones all over his, the anointed cherub that covers the throne. And then he would turn, and the reflection and the resonation of the glory of the presence of God, and he would lead. And then one day he decided to begin to saturate that unto himself. And the day on that day, what happened was angels became demons. He was cast down, left the throne uncovered. Now the throne is no longer covered. So you know what God says? Basically, he said, no biggie. I will create a people in the earth in Camarillo, California, and I'll just enthrone my praises. I'll just enthrone upon their praises. We got a people in future generations that are going to be redeemed by the blood of my son, and I'll just immerse myself in their lives. I'll cause my glory to be reflected upon their lives. Their worship will resonate me in such a way that people will turn to me because the overflow of their worship will become a force in the earth. That's what he was saying. And the enemy, now all along, the enemy is trying to work Jesus into one expression of worship. And he couldn't make it happen. And all along, the angels, the ones that are left in heaven, are sitting there holding their breath because Jesus is being tempted. That means he has to consider it, otherwise it's worthless. And in the middle of his temptation, if he says the wrong thing, that means the angels in heaven are cast out, and that means that the Father is dethroned eternally, and Lucifer, Satan, has won the battle eternally. That's how weighty this was. And Jesus had to consider it and be tempted. Worship is a powerful force that's sometimes not realized. We think it's singing in church. But now what happens? And so Jesus says, listen, knucklehead, I'll tell you what. Thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. Worship first, service second. So all of your service to the kingdom is out of the overflow of your worship. Therefore, it's empowered with the presence of God rather than striving out of the energy of the flesh to build ministry. Whatever you build out of the energy of the flesh, you get to maintain it by the energy of the flesh. And that's one of the reasons that we've got to be a people in our generation that's not about building ministry. We're about giving our life away, because that's what Jesus did. Now, when he says, worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve, the angels inhaled. And here they come. Read it. They swept down into that atmosphere and began to minister to Jesus. Glory, honor, power, strength, everything that had been given out in this battle. And Jesus walked right out of that moment, straight down to the river, and says, come on, boys. Throw down your nets. Here we go. We're going to build the kingdom. And out of the overflow of what just happened, rightly related to our Father, saying what we hear him saying, doing what we see him doing, let's get to healing people. Let's get to casting out demons. Let's get to doing the stuff. It's the overflow of what was just redeemed. All right. Got 3 minutes, so... okay, let's take five. Now, I'll end with this. Look what happened when he walked down there and he said, hey, come on, guys, throw down your nets. See, there's a lot of the Hebrew idioms that we, cultural idioms that we don't know about, so we don't always capture the weight of what was being said about. But what had happened was, is he said, like in the days of David, the young students of the word that are immersing them, their spirits in the word, to sing the word and carry the word, they would be like the rabbis would have a tablet, for example. Have you ever heard about this? It would be like a tablet about the size of this book. And they would be on the desk of each one of the young boys when he'd come in and sit down in the morning, and sister rabbi the night before would spread that tablet with honey, and they would put the word of God upon the board for them to memorize. And so when they would come in to memorize the word of God, they would write it with this stick in the honey, and as they're doing that, memorizing the word of God, they realize that thy word is honey unto my lips. And which means there's no disease, no bacteria can live in honey. It's the purest food in the world. No bacteria can live in honey. You know why it can't live in honey? Not because of the worker bee, not because of the queen bee, not because of the drone bee, but a little known bee that lives inside the hive called the fanner bee. The fanner bee is doing nothing but suspended and sustained in midair, in the wind, with these little wings, flying like this, like an intercessor. You know, these intercessory types that are just sustained and suspended, nowhere to truly land except in the spirit realm in prayer. And they're keeping the air purified from any kind of bacteria coming in because they're on post. And all the rest of them will go somewhere from a flower, they'll extract nectar, and then they'll take a beeline for the hive. And that beeline is to get that nectar in there where the atmosphere is pure and clean, and that will be health forevermore. Thy word is covered with those that are carrying and sustained and suspended day after day, generation after generation, carrying the pure word for the next generation to walk in the health of song. Now, when when Jesus walks down there and he says, "Hey, fellas," he starts talking to these guys. See, in those cultures back then, all of them went to study the Word of God in rabbinical school or whatever. And when they would go in and study the Word of God like that, then one day, it's cut day, basically. The rabbi walks in and says, "Okay, today you didn't make it. You don't have the skills and the talent. You're out of here. Okay, you can stay. All right, you go." So now the ones that didn't make it, they have to go be about their father's business. When they go be about their father's business, if the father is a carpenter, they're builders. If their father is a fisherman, they become fishermen. So what Jesus did is he walked down there and said, "Hey, look, throw down your nets and follow me. I will make you become what man says you could never be. Now, when you walk with me, you will begin to resonate and radiate. The overflow of relationship with the Father will bring you into your full destiny." And these guys that did not make the cut, didn't have all the charisma and the skill and the talent and the stuff, now you're the ones that are going to carry my kingdom. It's time for you get your song back, the one that's the dream born out of the worship of your own heart. So, Lord, I just speak that as a blessing and for every one of us, Lord. I pray that this will be the day that we begin to dream those dreams. Lord, I declare in this house that, when our memories become more powerful than our dreams, we sabotage our own futures and the future of those that will come behind us. So I speak dreams back in. Yes. Dreams to those that will carry the word. Dreams to those that will carry song and sound. Dreams to those that have been disappointed and basically set out to the net. And though we declare this day, take up your net and follow the Lord. Yes. Because there are those that we need some net casters. They were casting their net. Those brothers were, and he walked right on down the creek there, and they're the ones mending their nets. We need casters and menders walking with Jesus, and out of the overflow of their worship, carrying a pure, holy word and a pure presence of who he is, honey under their lips, full of the word of God, refreshing the atmospheres that they sing to in Jesus' name, creating purity in a culture that's impure because of what they're carrying of the honey of the word of God in their life. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. God bless you all.
Thank you, Ray. Thank you so much. I want us to pray for Ray so that we can just be sending him out in a blessed manner. I want you to know he's got some product that is going to be back in the Tom that you might want to get a hold of. And all of these messages are online, so you can catch up with everything and let it really find its way in. We're also going to put the buckets on either side, like by the stairs, that you could sow into his ministry, because we're going to get prayer for the nations going in the next 3 minutes. So let's just agree together. Why don't you stretch out your hand to Ray. Dear Father, we thank you for this man who carries a pure sound of Jesus and his victory and triumph and faithfulness and goodness and exaltation and delight. Thank you that he inspires anyone to hear that their song that God gave them is singable, hearable, and can be heard again and sang again and come alive. Thank you for his calling and his faithfulness and his journey. And we bless Ray. We want him to leave in a manner worthy of God. Fulfill the dreams as he takes off again to Ireland and Scotland and Wales in just a few weeks. Bless his calling to stir and release sound and awaken hearts to the sound of their destiny of Christ. Father, we sow our finances, rejoicing that in so doing we are agreeing with and we are receiving and completing the things that you're setting in motion in our life. We thank you for this next service that's coming. We just thank you for favor and rest and then power to be released in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Over here on either corner, we'll be starting prayer for the nations in a couple of days. Write your check to Jubilee Church. and that'll, this offering will go for Ray. Okay, the next service will be all about revival history. So maybe we're going to hear the rest of, we got all the way up to almost the Welsh revival, which is the big one. So it's next service, revival history.